We move on to talk about some of the top soccer headlines going on, and we start off, we'll talk about this a few times, but it's edging closer and closer. Dani Olmo is gonna be a Barcelona player. Barcelona has reached an agreement, or Barcelona reached a verbal agreement, whatever that means, with RB Leipzig to sign Dani Olmo. It's around 55 million euros with 7 million in add-ons. He's gonna be signing a 6-year contract with the club. He was one of their top targets this summer alongside Athletic, the main one, Athletic Club's Athletic Club winger Nico Williams, who had a brilliant campaign for Spain. So did Dani Olmo. You know, Barcelona in general in past, they've really dominated their team in terms of players that played on the Spanish national team. You know, you go back to that 2010 team that won the World Cup for Spain. There was like 7 or 8 starters that came from Barcelona. It was absolutely incredible. And that's what Barcelona has been able. They've always had the best in class in terms of Spanish players. Real Madrid, they've relied on those foreign Galacticos, you know, the Benzemas, the Bales, the Benzemas, the Bales, the Cristiano Ronaldos, the Toni Kroos, the Luka Modric, just from this generation. In the past, and you have the Steve McManamans, the David Beckhams, the Ronaldo Nazarios. They've been, you know, not a foreign club, but they've been willing to, you know, they've been willing to get the big names, the foreign sort of players. Spain, they've really looked in terms of, you know, they've had the Messis, they've had the Neymars, they've had the Suarezes, but you know, they've had the Iniestas, the Xavis, the Piqués, the Puyols, the Victor Valdezes, the David Villas, the Pedros, the Cesc Fabregas. They've always had the best in class in terms of Spanish talent, and they're taking advantage of this current Spain team that reached the European Championship. Dani Olmo was a huge critical part of this team, coming off the bench and being able to be the replacement for Pedri when he got injured, being able to get into the box, find pocket of space to get goals, controlling the play in terms of his ability and the ball, playing in tight spaces. They wanted to get Nico Williams to pair him up with Lamine Yamal to have that dynamite of verticality that Spain was able to have. They wanted to create that at Barcelona. They weren't really able to do that this season because of their financial issues, but they're able, it seems like they're gonna be able to get Dani Olmo in. I think that'll be a good addition for them. I think it's a little bit confusing in the fact that I think if you can't get Nico Williams, I would have got a world-class sort of number six that could have been sort of the replacement for Cesc Fabregas, could do that holding sort of midfield role. But Dani Olmo is still a really, really good player, and I think, you know, with Hansi Flick, he'll be able to deploy him. I think they'll make it work. This is gonna push Frenkie de Jong deeper in midfield, almost in the holding sort of role, which he's capable of playing. Is not his best position by any means, but he's capable of playing that role. So yeah. Christian Pulisic, he was able to score as AC Milan were able to defeat Barcelona in Baltimore at the Raven Stadium, the M&T Bank Stadium. These two teams, they're preparing for their club season. Lewandowski, he scored twice. Christian Pulisic, he was able to score for Milan, and they finished 2-2 before heading into a shootout in which Milan won. Pulisic, he was actually able to set up Jovic early in the first half, and then he scored on his own as well, with a nice little clever shot past Ter Stegen. And you know, Milan were up 2-0, and then Lewandowski, he pulled one back right before halftime, and then they were able to get that second. Lewandowski was able to get a second, 60th minute or so. Then they went to penalties, and honestly, who cares who won? I mean, it's preseason. But yeah, Real Madrid. They took on Chelsea. They ended their preseason tour, their American tour. They beat Chelsea 2-1 in Bank of America Stadium, the Carolina Panther Stadium in Charlotte. Mbappe, Jude Bellingham, they have not been involved at all in this preseason tour. Vinicius Jr., he actually played in this game. Madrid actually doubled their lead after Brahim Diaz, when Brahim Diaz actually was able to receive a ball from Vinicius Jr. and he was able to get past Chelsea's new signing, goalkeeper Philip Jorgensen. Chelsea, they didn't play really bad. They had a few opportunities. They pulled the goal from Nana Madueke, who got a cross from Enzo Fernandez, who's back playing games for Chelsea. We know that sort of situation that happened. But now Ancelotti and this Real Madrid time, they're going to turn their attention to the UEFA Super Cup. Well, they'll be taking on Atalanta. You know, this is a game between the last year's Champions League winner and last year's Europa League winner. It's their first chance for a trophy this season, a game that matters, not preseason game. This game does matter to an extent, and it's going to be the UEFA Super Cup. It'll be played on August 14th, which is next Wednesday. I believe, you know, they always play this game at really in a smaller stadium, has a chance for a little bit, you know, new fans, not smaller stadium, but in terms of, you know, not, you know, they don't play this at a Bernabeu, not Bernabeu, because that's obviously you can't, but they don't play this, you know, in the big stadiums, the Wembleys, you know, the big footballing, you know, known stadiums. This one will be played at the National Warsaw Stadium in Poland. They tend to, you know, really do a European tour in terms of these sort of games. What was something else that happened today? Let's take a look. Obviously, we know the Olympic soccer's Brazil and U.S. They're able to set up that gold medal game between the two. West Ham, they have signed Guido Rodriguez on a free transfer. They were able to sign Somerville and the big one, Niklas Füllkrug, over the past two games. Brilliant sort of summer for them. We'll see how they are under Julian Lopetegui. They're going to be an interesting team to watch. Very interesting team to watch in my opinion. I do like Füllkrug, really, really good player. Somerville as well. I think he's been really good for Leeds, has quality. Newcastle, they're close to agreeing to a £60 million deal with Crystal Palace for Gehi, which is going to be interesting because if that goes through, number one, will he be a starter for them immediately? You know, you sign a center back for £60 million plus. You want him, he needs to immediately go in as a starter. But Newcastle United, they have some proper center backs right now with Boatman and Fabian Scher, and also Dan Byrne. They have really good center backs already at the club. Does he get in there over those two immediately because of his transfer value? I think that's a little bit unfair. You know, they've been good servants for Newcastle, but if you're spending that sort of money, you know, it's look like immediately could be a starter. But I would also say Newcastle, you know, they could invest this sort of, you know, talent and money maybe somewhere else on the pitch. But again, you know, you want to take that next level, you do have to tidy up that defense, make it into the world-class level. Maybe they want to start off from back there, and they believe Mark Gehi is a guy that can develop to be world-class eventually. So yes, they'll take an initial hit in terms of, you know, breaking the center back partnership right now, being a little bit more, you know, vulnerable back there for the value that he can bring going forward in terms of him, you know, in terms of them being able to develop that sort of partnership. But yeah, that's, you know, I think Newcastle, they're, you know, they're slowly making their means to the next level. They're going to be getting, they'll be getting, Tonali back after his ban for loan. He's a really, really talented player. We'll see how he is going to be able to do, how he's going to be able to do with Newcastle. I believe his return date is set for October 20. When is he set to return? The third match day for the season. This season, so around that late August mark. So I think Newcastle has the means to have a good season, an improvement from last season, which they suffered just so many injuries and really had no sort of consistency in terms of players. game in, game out. Mexico, they were able to get past the USMNT in the U20 CONCACAF World Cup, or no, CONCACAF U20 Championship. They were able to beat the U.S. men's national team, coming back from behind to win 2-1. And yeah, it's just the continuation of a miserable, miserable U.S. men's summer for them. Obviously, the U21 is a small loss, but the Olympic Games and the Copa America, you know, been horrible, horrible, horrible. But thank you guys for tuning into the JSMC Soccer Podcast presented by the JSMC Sport Network. Your support means a lot to us, so please remember to subscribe to the show and leave a positive review. It really does make a difference. We also invite you to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, and Instagram for more content and updates. Thank you once again, and have a wonderful, wonderful day.
Let's go. I wake up to a little